afternoon, everyone. I'm Shankari Goldstein, host of the Inspiring Mind series for the Mind and Life Institute. I'm so glad that you could join us on what is a cloudy but still really beautiful day here in Virginia. I'd like to first take an opportunity to acknowledge the Monacan Indian tribe whose unceded land I'm joining you all from here in Charlottesville, Virginia. Please share where you are tuning in from as well in the chat so we can connect together as a community and maybe honor those ancestors. I also want to acknowledge and create a safer space of healing for our global majority communities of color and LGBTQ communities who continue to face daily acts of violence and systemic oppression. Know that the earth is holding you closely in these challenging times. At Mind and Life, we work to elevate leading edge insights at the intersection of science, contemplative wisdom, and action. We believe such knowledge is critical to cultivating personal well-being, building more compassionate communities, and strengthening the relationship between humans and the earth. We launched the Inspiring Mind series in October of last year as a way to meet the moment through engaging thought leaders in conversation with contemplatives and the wider audience to inspire action towards positive change. Past episodes have explored profound issues from the role of mindfulness in racial healing to how yoga, Tai Chi, and other embodied practices can help us access the profound wisdom that lies within our bodies. Our guests have shared from the heart how contemplative practices can help us navigate and take action related to the uncertainty, polarization, discrimination, and injustice that is so much a part of our daily lives. At our March Inspiring Minds, clinical psychologist Doris Chang shared how mindfulness was a crucial part of her journey to see racial programming and how toxic it is. For Doris, it helped to clarify how her actions could serve to maintain the status quo. At the same time, yoga teacher Reggie Hubbard showed us how to disrupt and rupture the narratives that have been suppressive and destructive. In their place, he said, we need to put forth narratives that are rooted in our authentic experience and compassion. Today, we move to a theme that I know has great significance for all of us, the role of attention and awareness in an era of misinformation and digital seduction. How can we be more vigilant and aware in the face of today's ever-present digital media? And what role can mindfulness play in nurturing pro-social civic engagement? These are questions that we're going to explore today with speakers Amishi Jha and Jon Kabat-Zinn. But first, we're going to set the stage for our time together with cellist Barbara Bogatin. But before we begin, I'd like to take a moment to thank Mind and Life supporters for their generosity, as well as all of you who've contributed during the registration process for this program. Your generosity is deeply appreciated. We're going to begin our episode with a contemplative offering from Barbara. Barbara has been a member of the San Francisco Symphony since 1994. She has appeared on numerous SFS video productions, including the Soundbox and Chamber Music series and current episodes on hip hop and Indian music, which can both be found on our website. Prior to this, she was principal cellist and soloist with the New Jersey and Milwaukee Symphonies and played frequently with the New York Philharmonic. She has given numerous talks about music practice and meditation, including a TEDx talk titled The Art of Failure. She received a bachelor and master's of music degree from the Juilliard School in New York. And I'd like to please welcome Barbara Bogatin.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure for me to be here today to share my music and my thoughts with all of you. But before I play, I'd like to introduce you to my life partner, my cello. So this is Giovanni. And Giovanni is named after his maker, who was Giovanni Battista Gabrielli. And Gabrielli created this beautiful hunk of wood in Florence, Italy, in 1752. I was lucky enough to find Giovanni in a musical instrument shop over 30 years ago. So we've been together now for quite a long time. And like most musicians and their instruments, we have a very close relationship. Now, it was just a couple of decades before Giovanni was created that the composer Johann Sebastian Bach created six monumental works for solo cello, which he called suites. And it was really the first time in the history of music that any composer had thought to write music of such complexity and emotional richness for a cello all by itself. And Bach was very aware that he was introducing the sound world of the cello to his audience. I'm going to play the first movement of the first suite that Bach wrote, called Prelude. And this prelude is in G major, which was a very joyful key for Bach. And it's written in a kind of stream of consciousness, free-flowing style, where Bach starts with a simple rhythmical idea, and then he elaborates upon it in a musical narrative, and he brings you home again at the end. And I'd like to invite you, as you're listening, to just let your mind and your heart follow the music wherever it takes you. And because we're going to be engaging in a conversation about contemplative arts, I would invite you, when the music is over and you hear the last resonance of the cello fade away, to close your eyes and let's sit all together for a few moments of silence. Now, welcome to the world of Johann Sebastian Bach and his prelude in G major.
Thank you so much, Barbara. Your cousin Lisa, who's tuning in right now, sends her gratitude and love and well wishes. So Barbara's going to be joining us, or rejoining us, I should say, again briefly to chat with Amishi and John. First, I'd love to do just a brief introduction of our two speakers today. First, Amishi Jha is an associate professor of psychology at the University of Miami, director of contemplative neuroscience for the Mindfulness Research and Practice Initiative. She received her PhD from the University of California, Davis, and received her postdoctoral training at the Brain Imaging and Analysis Center at Duke University in functional neuroimaging. She studies the neural basis of attention and the effects of mindfulness-based training programs on cognition, emotion, and resilience. With grants from the Department of Defense and several private foundations, she has been systemically investigating the applications of mindfulness training and education, corporate, elite sports, first responders, and military contexts. In addition to her own published body of research, her work has been featured in many outlets, including TED.com, NPR, Mindful Magazine, so much more, I'm sure. In addition, she's been invited to present her work to NATO, the UK Parliament, the Pentagon, the World Economic Forum. Her newest forthcoming book release, Peak Mind, can now be pre-ordered through major retail channels. Thank you for joining us today, Amishi.
Thank you so much.
And then we have Jon Kabat-Zinn, PhD, Professor of Medicine Emeritus at the University of Massachusetts Medical School, where he founded the Center of Mindfulness in Medicine, Healthcare, and Society, and its world-renowned mindfulness-based stress reduction, MBSR, clinic. He's the author of 10 books, including the bestsellers, Full Catastrophe, Living Wherever You Go, There You Are, and Mindfulness for Beginners. His work has contributed to a growing movement of mindfulness into mainstream institutions such as medicine, psychology, healthcare, neuroscience, schools, higher education, business, social justice, criminal justice, prison, the law, technology, government, professional sports. Over 700 hospitals and medical centers around the world now offer clinical programs based on the training that Jon has introduced in mindfulness and MBSR. Jon lectures and leads mindfulness workshops and retreats around the world. Thank you both so much for joining us today.
Nice to be here.
Two extraordinary presenters, and there's so much to unpack and discuss with each of you. So I'd love to just get started. So much of the topics for season one of Inspiring Minds have been around the handling of social and environmental injustices and challenges while in the midst of a deadly global pandemic and political unrest. Even as I say those words, there's energy in my body that I can feel shifting into this state of discomfort and almost stress. And there's probably cognitive shifts happening right now that are creating stressors in my body and mind. And I think so many of us are facing these changes in individual perceptions and stressors when we view the news and kind of watch these, almost like these plays happen sometimes outside of ourselves. And I recognize that so much of what we're gonna be talking about today are big questions. And I'll start with Amishi because I'm so fascinated by how you have developed such incredible research in the field around mind wandering. And then you connect these mindfulness programs to communities that really need it to be more accessible, such as teachers, office workers, and the military. So perhaps you can share some insights around your continued research, your new book, and touch on how you feel we may be losing valuable aspects of our daily lives in the distraction of our own minds. How do we own our own attention?
Happy to, and such an honor and privilege to be here with you, Shankri, and of course, Jon and Barbara, and the entire community. I mean, it's just wonderful to see that we are joined by the world and people from around the world that share an interest in these topics. I'm just thrilled to be here and have an opportunity to chat with you all today. I guess I will just start by answering that question by really emphasizing what attention is. So really, and it's tied to the title we have too, right? We talk about attention and awareness in the title of our session today. And that's what I study in my lab. I'm a brain scientist, as Shankri, you mentioned. And really we focus on two aspects of attention. The fact that it can be highly concentrated, like a laser pointer, but also very broad and receptive. And we need this extremely powerful brain system for so many things, from our ability to notice, select, direct the brain's computational resources to things like decision-making, regulating our emotions, and really connecting with other people. So what we have learned in my lab, in our work, is that sure, this brain system is extremely powerful, but it's also quite vulnerable. And circumstances, very much like what we've all collectively experienced over the last year, something we often describe as VUCA conditions, V, volatile, U, uncertain, C, complex, and A, ambiguous. So the kinds of populations that we've worked with experience VUCA, not just in the unusual context of a global pandemic, but really it's part and parcel of their professional and personal lives. So we've been very, very fortunate to be able to partner with groups like teachers, like first responders and military service members and family members to offer practices like mindfulness meditation, very much inspired by my dear teacher, Jon Kabat-Zinn, to provide a salve or a training opportunity to make these precious brain resources of attention more available to them when they need them. And that pretty much connects to the question you were asking about my book. I appreciate you mentioning it. Really, the book Peak Mind, which will be out in October, as you mentioned, is the story of attention, how powerful it is, how vulnerable it is, and really that there is a possibility for us to train it. And this training component goes to what I'm really hoping we'll have a chance to talk about, the notion of owning our attention. It sounds a little strange, but we already talk about our attention as a currency, right? We talk about paying attention. But it's not just a currency that we offer up. It is a commodity. And it is a commodity in the attentional economy, which is what we are all part of, whether we know it or not, whether we like it or not. And it's this aspect that I think is quite problematic as a modern day predicament that we're all in. And it's also requiring of us to be aware of our attention so we know where it is. And if we don't know where it is as a starting point, there's no way we're going to be able to have any kind of control over it to use it in a way that we find most beneficial, whether it's, again, focusing or broadening. Mm-hmm. So I think that this is where we are in our present moment is talking about these topics, not just from a personal journey point of view, but really the personal is political in many ways. And this is our collective task at hand.
Mm. So much of what you shared resonated with me, and it really highlights the importance of mindfulness as the key to really fixing these stressors that we've been talking about through the pandemic. And it also seems like we're, you know, as we own our own attention, we're constantly being asked to make these choices. In many ways, it requires us getting to the root of the problems that we're facing in this era of like hyper-individualism. And it leads me to think of the word desire. You know, what is influencing our choices in this moment? So much of our desires are external, our phones, computers, televisions. We require these things to stay connected, and yet we're more disconnected than ever, it feels like. And so I'd love to hear from you, John, you know, in a response to Amishi's question, but also, why do you think that is? Why do you think even with all of these external tools, we feel so disconnected? And what do we mean when we talk about digital seduction? What does that mean to you?
Well, first of all, lovely to be here with both Amishi and Barbara, and to just really bathe in the Bach suite that Barbara offered us, and the invitation to attend to it in all of the ways that a human being can, which are multiple and complex. And so just listening to a piece like that, a work of art, is transcendent, transportive, and also in some sense, grounding us in the listening, in the present moment, in the not just listening, but hearing. So Amishi's, you know, work is just so relevant to the nexus of what humanity is facing at this moment on every single level, whether we're talking about racial injustice or global warming or economic injustice, that what we pay attention to allows us to actually navigate in the world effectively as human beings, not merely autonomous, but completely interconnected with each other, as you were pointing out, Shankar. And it's incredibly important that we are aware of what happens with our attention, where it goes and where it doesn't go, and how important it is for us to listen to other people who have different perspectives, because they can point out what we're really blind to because it's not part of our universe. So for instance, just men listening to women is like really important because it's a vast generalization, but there are certain lenses that you can bring to something that actually distort or blind you to another person's experience. And insofar as it's possible to attend and be aware of difference in other people, and then what the costs of not doing that are, that's huge. And so mindfulness is not merely sitting on a meditation cushion and calming one's own mind and having some extended periods by the clock of well-being and kind of profound restoration of one's humanity, but it's actually taking that restored humanity, which is restored moment by moment by moment, really, and bringing it out into the world that have, in ways that have integrity, that are ethically grounded, and so forth, and that recognize the deep roots of suffering wherever they emerge. So that's why mindfulness is so potentially important in everything that the human species is facing at the moment. And if we don't start with where our attention is and how we can befriend it and then reclaim it so that it's not a commodity that's basically sold to other people without our awareness, and we're so entrained into it that we no longer know that we're captivated by external phenomena that do not have our necessary interest at heart, and that actually erode the not only the quality, but the actual moments that we can have an embodied, alive existence, because we're basically entrained into an autopilot mode of whether it's commercialism and buying stuff, or whether it's looking for the perfect whatever that will complete my life, and at the end of the day, having missed the entirety of one's life, as Thoreau was very famous for having said.
Yeah, I love that you talked about, you know, connecting with the practice and then finding a way to really bring it out into the world, and finding ways to attend, use that word attend, to our internal light, our internal landscape. I always like to think it's finding ways to connect to every moment of your day and really like forming a practice around every quality, like the quality of each moment. But I think the reality is that for most of our community watching, is that they just feel like they don't have the time to practice. And these ideas, these concepts, they're so big, they're so vast. You know, what we're talking about here is referring to teachings like Patanjali's Yoga Sutra, cultivating devotion to the supreme, ever blissful light within us. You know, Amishi, I'm turning to you now. How do we break down such a paradoxical, these paradoxical teachings of ancient wisdoms? You know, like, if I know one thing, I know nothing. If we must embrace everything, then everything is something. Or, you know, even just acknowledging that this recreational vehicle that I'm temporarily driving around in isn't even real, you know? How do we connect perhaps a public pre-K teacher down the street facing Zoom fatigue, systemically under-resourced, managing her own household or his or her own household, with these deep philosophical wisdom teachings? And how do we explain to them how they can weave it into their daily life?
I mean, I think that the explanation is the second part of the explanation that I think we could be helpful with. Mm-hmm. The value and the calling to a deeper sense of wholeness and wellness is there. We don't need to direct anybody to that. We feel it. Usually we feel it as an absence of something. And one of the real kind of passion points for me is to actually bring people to these practices, to mindfulness practices, who may not even identify themselves as experiencing stress. I mean, this comes from my own experience. You know, I would say I was never interested in meditation. It seemed like something that was for my parents coming from India. Some of my earliest memories are watching my father practicing meditation, and it was wonderful to see him doing that as a disciplined practice, but I was like, that's not for me. And I certainly didn't identify myself as a stressed out person who needed any kind of solution. It always seemed like it was something about the external circumstances that were causing me to have some kind of difficulty or challenge. So the first thing I think that is something that we can all do and have done really in the work of the people that we're talking about today, or with today, is offer that there is an aspect to this that we can turn to. There is an aspect that has to do with us, and it's something we can cultivate. And it truly is tied to this fundamental ability to harness our brain's energy, which is all attention is. Attention really evolved to solve a big problem that the brain had, which is that there's far more information in the environment than it could possibly process. So it had to come up with a solution, which is, okay, let's constrain and narrow so that at least whatever's within this particular constrained field of view, I can process more. But it ends up that capacity which is such a gift of evolution, is also the thing that can actually leave us feeling stressed out, depleted, and unhappy. So part of the journey, I think, is reminding us to just pay attention to our attention, even if all we do at first without even formally practicing is to just take this sort of observational stance. Where does my mind go? Does my mind go to worrisome thoughts? Does my mind go toward scarcity and worry? And how much of that is tied to the nature of what is truly happening versus my sort of extrapolation of what might happen? Mm-hmm. Just that is as a first step before we can go in and offer anything. But what I was going to say is that, you know, sort of concretely, because I like to, you know, it's nice to say that people should pay attention to their attention. People might have no idea what I'm talking about. But one of the approaches that we've taken is, and we're very fortunate, is to be able to have a starting point, not just from the traditions where people could go on multi-month retreats or have practices that are part of their community and their culture, but to actually have programs like those that, you know, John has spearheaded in the world, mindfulness-based stress reduction, which provided a pathway that didn't require any particular worldview and prescribed in a manualized way, you know, and I use that term, there's an art to that, but still in a way that people could follow. So there was a way forward. And my work has really been able to pick up the baton from that and say, yes, this is something we can lean on. And you don't need to be any kind of particular person to benefit. But maybe you can't spend the amount of time. Maybe stress reduction isn't something that you think that is even relevant to you. So we've catered our programs so that people are getting access to them in the context of being very time pressured people that are interested in their operational performance success without ever even using the word stress reduction or even symptom reduction.
Did you want to respond to that, John, or have any reflections on what she just shared?
Just to say, because I mean, we could go on for hours about this, and I want to make sure that we, you know, in some sense adhere to what you'd most like to draw out of us, one of the things that we're realizing is that there's really no separation between attention and life or awareness and life. And therefore, the real meditation practice doesn't take any time at all. It's living your life as if it really mattered in the only moment any of us ever have, which is now. And so if we are in some sense entrained or enslaved into attention capture and we're not aware of it, then we can actually, you know, suffer the consequences in enormous ways. Once we become aware of it, then we have a certain degree of fungibility or flexibility is how we will adapt to even our phone or our email or whatever it is. And the sense of like, oh, maybe I'm missing something, or maybe my life's not complete unless I listen to this, this, and this. And of course, now the amount of stuff that's available to us in digital form and assaulting us is 24/7, and it's like exponentially increasing beyond imagination, so that we're losing our analog life. We're becoming digitized in ways that are potentially really toxic, although many of them are quite hopeful and helpful. So we need to find, we're at a juncture for humanity where we need to find out how to work with our own technological precocity without abandoning our analog beauty that we haven't even yet in the whatever 600 generations of human history, even lived our way into fully at this point in time. So it's really, to my mind, meditation or mindfulness practice is really a love affair with what's deepest and best in us as human beings. And of course, everybody will have that experience differently. And that's why we need each other and each other's wisdom and perspective in that kind of thing. And we also, at the same time, need to really understand how this calls for us to be ethical and embodied and remember what it is that we don't know, and then value other voices that can actually point this out to us, and then make sure that our understanding is not merely theoretical, but embodied. And so we're talking really about not merely attention or awareness, but an embodied embrace of those in a way that is not only life affirming, but in some profound way, joyful. And I think the Bach brought that joy out. The amount of discipline that it takes to do what Barbara does, I mean, it's like extraordinary. Or for Bach to have written it in the first place, where does that even come from? But every single person has their own kind of genius available to us, if only we would make room to listen that deeply to what's really being called for.
Yeah, let's bring Barbara into the conversation now, and kind of it's like such a good segue to move beyond that preoccupation of the self-identity spaces that push us to become browsable characters in a digital world. And so, Barbara, I'd love to bring you on because you're a cellist who is in deep relationship with a 300-year-old classical tool, and you just helped really ground the energy for the episode. And something that Mind and Life does really well that I've always appreciated is showcasing the connection between art, contemplation, and science. So perhaps you can just share and reflect on some of your work with the Buddha, the brain, and Bach, and maybe how a relationship with music and art can bring us back to a deeper connection with that analog self.
Sure. So what Shankari was referring to is I developed a workshop along with my husband, who's a neuroscientist, Cliff Saran, and part of his research involves how the brain is active during meditation. And we developed a workshop along with Sylvia Borstein, a wonderful meditation teacher and a dear friend, which we talked about the parallels between music practice, meditation practice, and neuroplasticity, which is the brain's ability to change. And we came up with the alliterative title, The Buddha, the Brain, and Bach, to refer to the three elements that we try to weave together in our workshops. So for me, playing the cello has always been a lot about focusing my attention, and I loved the way John phrased befriending our attention. Because if you've ever tried to learn a musical instrument, or perhaps you have a child who's tried to learn an instrument, you know that practice is a very big component in that process. And one has to practice all the time to play an instrument. And people often say to me, you know, you still have to practice that thing. You've been playing it for more than 50 years. And my response to that is, you know, if I didn't touch my cello for, say, 10 years and then picked it up, I could still play it. I'd still be able to play it probably reasonably well. But to maintain the level of expertise that I need to play with my orchestra, the San Francisco Symphony, or to play a piece in public by myself, then I definitely do need to practice. And in order to practice in a very conscious way, I need to make sure that my attention, while it will be wandering at different times, that I'm constantly bringing it back to my internal world, the physical sensations within my body. Is there excessive tension? Am I able to coordinate my hands in the appropriate way? And bring my attention back to my listening awareness. So I need to really slow down my physical motions and my thought processes so that I can fully be aware of exactly what I'm doing and how to best improve. And then when time comes to give a performance, it's important to really let go of all of that practice and focused attention, and then bring my attention to my internal space so that I can really focus on the emotion of the composer that I'm trying to express when I play. And all of this is helped by the cultivation of a kind attention and the ability to, when the mind wanders, just simply bring it back without judgment, without critique, just accepting wherever the mind goes, as the wonderful title of John's book, Wherever You Go, There You Are. And the ability to bring the mind back, to to focus the attention on your personal center. That is something that we can cultivate during contemplative practice.
Thank you. John, maybe you can reflect a little bit of how you view art and science being woven together and how they can lead to states of consciousness or a deeper connection to the analog self, and maybe even talk about what the analog self is, because we have a few people asking what you mean by that.
What I mean by that is what we were until the arising of the digital age. In other words, we are, every single one of us, a total universe. There are actually more atoms in your body than there are stars in the Milky Way galaxy. An unimaginable number of atoms that are actually mostly empty space, but very, very tiny foci of energy. And this actually allows for those atoms to connect in ways that create molecules and that create cells and that create all sorts of structures that actually do process information and that actually can locomote and attend and through various kinds of sensory domains, and then a brain that organizes all of this. And the brain itself is like trillions upon trillions of connections that are constantly changing, driven to a large degree by experience and also by practice, by repetition, by working things, exercising over and over and over again. And the brain is our organ of learning across the lifespan, high degree of neuroplasticity. It's the organ that changes its own structure in response to experience. At least that's my understanding of it, not being a neuroscientist.
And no, so that's great.
We are embodied miraculous beings, virtually from the before birth to the end of our lives. And if we could actually appreciate that that's not true just for us, but for every single being on the planet, and even the planet is so rare an event in the galaxy, never mind the universe, which is unimaginably large, and that there's no planet B for us to, you know, escape to if we screw it up with this one. And there's no question that our incredible brain is actually so precocious that without some kind of awareness of what it is, an awareness of awareness or meta-awareness, that we run the risk of actually incinerating the experiment of life on this third planet from our sun in a relatively short period of time, because history's only been past 5, 6, 7,000 years. That's only about 600 generations or 900 generations, not that much. So whether we're talking about art or whether we're talking about science, we're talking about, in a sense, a deep exploration of beauty, of order, of organization, of what it means to put things together and have something larger than the sum of its parts emerge from it, that actually has very interesting properties like speech and vision and deep interconnectedness. And so we're beginning to actually realize, in the sense of make real, what it is that we are as human beings. That's what I mean by the analog domain. It's extremely complex. It's extremely beautiful. We've barely scratched the surface. But what's most important in the theme of this program is that we not destroy ourselves before we actually discover the true nature of what it means to be human, individually and collectively, with all our similarities and all our beautiful differences. And the music of this, and the art of this, is when I watch and listen to Barbara playing, for instance, I actually sometimes imagine that it's not Barbara playing the cello, but in some sense, the cello playing Barbara, or Bach playing both of them, or all of it engaged in some miraculous thing that if we did this again tomorrow, it would be the same, but it would be different. And that's true for every single one of us in every single moment. And the question is, can we wake up to that and then bring the full repertoire of our humanity to whatever degree it's possible, to all of the most difficult and also the most beautiful challenges that we have. And that would be a certain kind of dance. So science then becomes a certain kind of art, a certain kind of playful exploration of what it means to be awake, that, you know, what matter is, what energy is, what space is, what empty space is. It's not so empty, according to quantum mechanics. And so there are all sorts of beautiful intersections with the meditative traditions, and particularly the traditions that have cultivated mindfulness at the level of the body, at the level of the mind, and at the level of our thoughts and emotions, in ways that are incredibly relevant to us threading the needle of the challenges that humanity is facing at the moment.
Yeah, so let's help and slowly, you know, finish threading that needle of this conversation. You know, so much of what the three of you have shared today is about connecting to traditional ways of being, traditional practices against technological advancements. And I'd love to just weave in pro-social behaviors and how our emotions and our actions have the potential to create a more healing outcome, which I think you've each touched on in different ways. We know that basic human psychology suggests that people have a tendency to conform to their group, which you touched on a little bit, John, earlier, and that they can fit in and be well-liked. And over time, those values and beliefs shared by a group become more similar. But what about those who have different beliefs that we have different belief systems from, you know, talking about this human to human connection, maybe different ethics, different values? I'd love to maybe hear from you, Amishi, how constructive emotions, pro-social behaviors can ease suffering and heal our societies and unite us as we start to emerge in this post-pandemic world.
These are such profound and important things to talk about. But I wanted to actually, and I'll connect it to what you just said, Shankri, but I wanted to go back to something John said in the spirit of playful, artful conversation, which is that the human mind, the human brain has not actually changed all that much. So from the moment we could say we've become digitized, well, the brain's not any different than it was, you know, a couple thousand, more than that, years ago. And frankly, the challenges that people have suffered from are also the same. There's some wonderful accounts of medieval monks talking about their minds are just so busy. I mean, they've got to think about lunch, and then there's prayer, and then there's these distracting thoughts. I mean, they remove themselves from life. They stop talking to their families because the mind is just so distractible that they can't focus on God. And so that to me is very humbling, because it says they didn't have cell phones, they didn't have Zoom, and they suffered in a very similar way. And I wanted to actually just say that I don't think that there is anything wrong with our minds. There's nothing wrong with our brain, and there's nothing wrong with our attention. In fact, it's extremely predictable, powerful way of being that is causing us to experience some suffering. But it is behaving in a very logical manner, as it has been designed over the course of millennia to behave. And specifically what I mean by that is that we are built, our brains, our minds are built to have a truth bias. And I can say definitely more about what I mean by that. They're built to have a novelty bias, a confirmation bias, a self-privileging bias. These are things that are just part and parcel of what the hardware and the processes that are what a brain is entail. So now when you've got a news feed that is feeding you facts, that is making things interesting and enticing because they're fear-inducing or surprising, that is allowing you to have certain views and then constraining the flow of information so it always aligns with that in terms of confirmation, we're going to be in a world of trouble, which we are. And, you know, this discussion goes back quite a ways, all the way back to when the development of this country, for example, and what should we think about with regard to free speech? And it came from really, Descartes talked about this as, well, yes, humans are rational. And as long as they have knowledge and logical reasoning, and they can have nice debate with each other, they will be able to be successful in the marketplace of ideas. But what he didn't know, which we now know, through the brain science of how these things work is, well, we're not all that rational, actually, that's the first thing, but that it's not that every idea we hear, we just fully are neutral about, and then we decide to believe it. It's actually what I said by truth bias is the way it goes. So hearing, actually, let me put it this way, comprehending is believing. Just in the same way seeing is believing. So if you're looking at your computer screen right now, you're not doubting that it exists, right? A physical monitor exists. You're not saying, oh, I wonder if that's real. That could be a figment of my imagination. If you perceive it, it is real. And the comprehension system of the brain is an outgrowth of the perceptual system. So the default is if I understand it, it is true. It is not a mirage, it is true. And it takes post-processing. So after it's believed, you actually need to put energy into unbelieving. And that's where the rational mind, that's where the logical decision-making, and that's where the debate with others is critical. So now take all of that and think about our current moment where social media feeds are constrained, where bubbles are proliferated, and where there is the kind of commodity of our attention to be consuming this content keeps us frozen on certain kinds of ideas and certain kinds of content. So I just wanted to say that the deck is not stacked against, I mean, the deck is stacked against us, let's just put it that way. Everything about the current moment we're in takes everything good and evolved about our brain's attention system, at least, and uses that in the service of a particular way of interacting with digital content. So one last point, and then I want to make sure I share the time with regard to prosocial behavior. We're bringing it back to your question, Shankri. I think that the first thing to realize is that we're not in a level playing field. That whatever it is that our worldview is, whatever we consider to be our in-group, all of our media and digital touch points overprivilege that. And so to break out of that bubble will take a lot. It'll take a lot of our personal energy. It'll take a lot of our awareness. And the chances of that happening by just saying it are zero because of all the reasons I just said of the sort of programming of the brain. So I actually see mindfulness as one of the only ways out of this. I mean, it's nice to say, talk to somebody who doesn't share your worldview, but how are you going to actually materialize that? I mean, think about your own life. Think about a neighbor that you don't agree with, has a political candidate's, you know, bill like sign on their lawn, and you're like, I don't think so. I don't want to really engage with them. What is it going to take in you to be able to have that dialogue and discussion? Now take that and amplify it, you know, millions of folds when we're talking about people. This is where mindfulness can be helpful. And this is what I meant by, you know, the personal is political. We need to cultivate these practices to get ourselves out of the conundrum we're in so we can be reminded of what being pro-social actually means in this all-encompassing manner.
Yeah. Thank you, Amishi. And thank you for bringing, you know, up the shared three points of bias, truth, novelty, and confirmation. And people can follow more about that concept in the registered viewers will have access to a post-event mailer, and we're going to share the link to that Mindful Magazine article that you just wrote. And I love that you talked about how the biases can play out or be like help frame these bigger, broader conversations around race, equity, and even potentially the climate crisis. I want to be mindful of time, and I would love to like hear John's response to that, but there is a lot of questions for the three of you in the chat, and people are eager to come on and talk with you. And I just want to thank each of you so much for the teachings today. It's such a gift to know that we keep coming back to these dialogues and conversations, even if we are experienced practitioners. One, just to be in community, to be in sangha with one another, and then to be mirrors of the teachings and how we live in these moments. And lastly, to just keep being students of the work. You know, the work is ever evolving, it's ever shifting, everything in this world always is, as each of you have shared. And I just wanna thank each of you for helping us come closer to this realization that we are multi-dimensional beings in this journey called life. It's been really an honor. But I do want to move into this public Q&A time with our three presenters. Please continue to populate questions in the chat box so that I can ask them for you directly. We'll also have the option for you to raise your hand, which many of you already do have your hands raised now directly through the Zoom feature. And I'll bring you up live to verbally ask your question. I'll keep my eyes open for the virtual raised hands. And at that point, I'll invite you to unmute your mic and voice your question. So we do have a question here from Bia Spadassini. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly. This is actually for all three of you, but I'm gonna start with Barbara to kind of bring her up. So much requires our focused attention these days that it can wear us down. And in the pandemic, everything has gone virtual, which makes it really hard to actually not focus. Would you recommend more frequent interruptions to help us be in our body instead of our heads so that when we do pay attention, we're actually focused and we're not worn out from Zoom fatigue? Yes. Do you have any suggestions for that?
Sure. That's a great question. And it's certainly, for my own profession, the performing arts have been hit very hard by this pandemic. What we do gathering together in small and close-knit groups to audience members sitting very close together, that's something we haven't been able to do for over a year. And so a lot of music making has gone digital. But I think that the idea of music and all of the arts can really speak to this idea that John was talking about, what it means to be human. And so what I would recommend is as much connection with the arts as possible. It brings us back into this sense of community. And particularly with music, as Leonard Bernstein, the great conductor and composer, said, music can speak where words cannot. It can express the unknowable. And I'm sure many people have had the experience of, say, driving in the car and being very upset about something, and you're angry and you're totally distracted and not paying attention to where you're going. And then a song comes on the radio, and it could be anything. It doesn't have to be Bach. It could be a Beatles song or Beyonce or Brandy Carlile. And it just touches you in a very deep way all of a sudden. And you can find that your anger starts to melt away and you're less distracted, and you become much more aware of the compassion that's coming out of that singer or that violinist. And this can connect us to just being present in the moment. And then you might realize as you're driving that, oh, there's a tree with beautiful flowers right now. And the kind of compassion and heart wisdom that comes from connecting through music in particular is something that really can bring us back to our best selves.
Thank you. So yeah, go on a drive, Bia, or a walk and listen to some music to help bring a little bit of fluctuation to your routine. I'm gonna invite Linda up to ask her question. Linda Cantor? You can go ahead and unmute yourself. Or maybe not. I'm gonna maybe pick somebody else. Okay, we're gonna go to Sperry.
Yes, hi. This topic is, I feel, as has been just said, so relevant. The potential for collective consciousness in a world of collective unconsciousness. How do we wake up together? I've been exploring that for 40 years with thousands of people internationally, how to share, be aware of awareness mindfully at a collective level. I think we have to move towards collective mindfulness. What do you all have to say about that?
Well, I'll jump in first if that's okay. I mean, absolutely. That's exactly what the evolutionary arc of this is all about, is a certain kind of deep recognition of the full dimensionality of our humanity, individually and collectively, and then bringing it to the world in ways that maximize well-being and benefit and minimize harm, and both obvious harm and not so obvious harm. So this is something that is really important and fundamentally ethical. And it's a profound element of meditative practice from the very beginning. So it's not kind of a skin graft or an add-on at a certain point. The deep question is, what is our motivation for acting in the world? And if the motivation is to actually leave some degree of benefit, reduce suffering, that is something that really is important. And it's not like, oh, I'll reduce everybody else's suffering, but I don't have time for my own, because the ignorance that that projects will just create more suffering in and of itself. So we have to both take care of ourselves and take care of the world. And this is a certain kind of a yoga. So we need to practice it. We need to exercise the muscle. And the beauty of mindfulness is there's no time except for perhaps deep sleep, unless you're into lucid dreaming, where even that would be fine, where you can't be actually stretching the envelope and inhabiting the full dimensionality of our possibilities moment by moment by moment. And then in some sense, reclaiming and discovering and uncovering what it means to be human in the 21st century and how we can best contribute to leaving our children and our children's children and future generations an inhabitable planet that is healthy and where there's a certain degree of real equality in terms of the opportunity to live a life of embodied integrity and well-being and dignity. And I'll just also throw in that although we seem to be on top of a million different crises, it's really important to remember that we've always, throughout human history, been on top of a million different crises. So without belittling any of those crises, because they are enormous, I also want to point out that we're capable of rising to this occasion if we wake up, which is what mindfulness is all about. It's the word Buddha means awaken, the awakened one. It doesn't mean, you know, some kind of arcane idea of contrived wisdom. It means wake up to the actuality of things. It's a lot simpler than often the philosophers will, you know, sort of create pictures of, although not dissing the philosophers. And I would like to just kind of put in a plug here for the Netflix movie, The Social Dilemma, that the wonderful people like Tristan Harris and the people at the Center for Humane Technology have offered us. If you haven't seen The Social Dilemma, you've got to see it tonight, if not this afternoon or whatever time zone you're in. It's that important. And a lot of the people in that movie who have created this technology, they're actually now practicing mindfulness and trying to understand how to not put the genie back in the bottle, because there's no putting the genie back in the bottle, but to, in some sense, constrain it and contain it so that it serves human values and doesn't turn us all into commodities.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to bring up Satish. I believe he has a question for Amishi. Satish, are you there to ask your question?
Yeah, can you hear Dr. Jamal? Yeah.
Yes.
So I have a question regarding the disconnect between academia and public. So whenever we discuss, and probably we are privileged to be sitting and talking among like American public in context of American public. And I don't, when having said that, I don't mean there's anything wrong about that, but I come from a place where I have seen that there is a huge disconnect or maybe it could be a language. Do you think it's a barrier or some other medium which is not really helping to get this message back in the public? When I say public, means a global public, not just the American public, which I think is much more privileged or or aware about mental health or inequality or injustices. But it's also not happening just in America, but happening all around the world. Especially I have been seeing in India and also many other Asian countries. So do you think that there is some sort of disconnect between academia and the global public, that this message of what in wisdom we are, you know, discussing here is not reaching out there to the public who are really suffering a lot?
Thank you, Satish.
That's a great reminder of where we're at, and in many ways the point of privilege that, you know, all of us that are able to be here and have this conversation. It goes back to the point I was raising earlier, that for many people that are in this mode of extreme demand, hardship, there's not even the capacity to evaluate what the moment is. You're just in it. And so, you know, I mentioned at the outset that attention is this very vulnerable, powerful yet vulnerable capacity. It's also extremely limited. It's so limited. It gets spent out so easily. So I think part of the answer to what to do about the dissemination of this information is is to, first of all, kind of meet people where they're at, meaning that If you are, I mean, it was interesting. When I was in India, actually, I was invited by the police chief of one of the town I actually grew up in. He had heard about my work with the military and invited me to come talk to him regarding how to bring mindfulness to the police force there. And one of the first questions I asked is, how often do your police officers get days off? Because when I see police officers, at least in Ahmedabad and in India, they're on the street, they're outside, blaring sunlight all day, every day. And his response was, oh no, they don't have days off. And to me, that was like, mindfulness is not the conversation we should be having. Everything I would suggest is informed by the spirit of what we're talking about, awareness of what's going on, awareness of what people are experiencing, the challenges that they have. I mean, I think that Satish, you bring up such a good point regarding dissemination of this information. And I think people like you and me and everybody probably listening is part of that. It's part of extending this conversation beyond just the Zoom meeting, to have the conversations within our groups, to break those barriers and talk to people we might not even want to or necessarily feel we can talk to bring about the importance of our own capacities to be successful and healthy in our world, to be successful and healthy. And when I hear words like collective, I'm always remembering that the collective is a group of people, group of individuals, a group of individual entities that are all kind of massed together. And what we say and how we interact and how we treat each other is part of what will cause the collective chain of reaction. So I hope that that kind of gets at it. I think that there's a long way to go, but we have to be part of the solution in every moment if we carry some awareness that we feel others aren't exposed to yet.
If I could add one other thing in that regard, I want to really stress that mindfulness is not some kind of upper middle class, white privileged kind of thing that only, you know, sort of people who have everything and don't know what to do with their time, they go into meditation. This is really where the rubber meets the road in terms of our full humanity. And so the practices that we are talking about are, you know, available in ways that they really have never been before, not merely on the internet, but everywhere. I mean, there are more meditation teachers in the world now than I'm sure than there have ever been before. The same is true for yoga teachers. Yoga itself is a different door into the same thing. Yoga is meditation and meditation is yoga, in the same way as what we were talking about, art and science, where, you know, the sort of composer and the instrument and the player of the instrument. I mean, that there's a certain way in which the question itself invites a kind of deep inquiry about, okay, how could we recognize a particular local problem in our own particular life and actually act to ameliorate it in some way or other? 20 years ago, the idea of bringing meditation into K through 12 education was considered like, you know, lunatic fringe. Now it's very much integrating itself into public education in the United States and many other countries. So I would urge everybody who's listening and to ask yourself, what is it that your karma invites you to pursue, to contribute to this unfolding of wakefulness and attention in whatever way resonates deeply in your own heart? And it will be of profound benefit in the world. And that's how the world's going to change, by every single one of us, in some sense, taking responsibility for the tiny little piece that if we don't do it, nobody else is going to do it.
I want to add one more kind of comment to that, and then we'll go on. I know there's a lot of questions. That, you know, yes, it is the case that it's not for a select few, but for many, it has been a challenging kind of cultural container in which to get access to mindfulness practices in many ways, because they just don't see them as available for themselves. I'm just reminded of an episode when, again, I was in India, and I gave a talk about my research, which had actually constrained the amount of practice time, where we found that about 12 minutes a day, 5 days a week or so, we were finding to have beneficial effects. And one of the people in the audience raised a very nice older uncle, raised his hand and said, "Why are you telling us about meditation? This is an Indian practice. This came about here." Kind of challenging me to say, "Why are you coming in here, you Western trained scientist, and telling us about how great meditation is?" And it was hilarious in some ways, because before I could even speak, another member of the audience raised her hand and said, "You're talking about going away on a month long retreat? I work, I have children, I don't have time to do that." She's giving us a way we can do this right now as a mom, as a working mother. I can actually implement this. And that's what I love about the kind of proliferation that we're seeing. People are getting very creative. People are benefiting from the scientific results. And I think that, again, many of the modalities of training that have come about more recently are benefiting from the wisdom of the traditions across the world, but are offering mindfulness in very accessible ways, no matter what your particular life circumstance.
Thank you. I'm going to invite Ginny Saunders to come up and ask a question, if she's still there, or they are still there.
Oh, hello.
Hi.
John, I have another chance to ask you. You called on me one time during the mitigation retreat, and I think I asked you the same question I want to ask you now. I knew I didn't know the answer to my question then, but you told me I did know the answer, and that was the question is how to bring awareness if I'm beginning to develop it, which I at that time in August thought I was developing, not knowing, how could I bring what I know about awareness, which now is it comes in the form of neuroplasticity, and let others know that all of us have that capacity to continue developing no matter how old we are. It's still available to us if you would give yourself that opportunity to experience it. And that's what I would love to be able to do now. Thank you, John.
Thank you, Jenny.
Well, nice to hear your voice again. And, you know, I'm tempted to go with the same answer I gave you last time. And I hear it in your voice that, you know, I'm really reluctant to give people prescriptions about how to go about this kind of thing. I think what's more appropriate is to invite all of us to ask deeply, to listen deeply to what our heart is actually telling us or inviting out of us, and then trust it, because I think it's really trustworthy. And then just take a step. And it doesn't really matter what it is, because one step will lead to another. I'll tell you that in MBSR, you know, every time I walk into a classroom of medical patients, I always felt like I'm learning far more than any of them are learning. I'm learning more from them. I should be paying them for what they're teaching me, because we're always teaching each other. So that's what I meant by just starting wherever you are and seeing what one particular opening might be. Take that and then let the world become your meditation teacher. And that's a kind of meditation practice in its own right, because rather than getting an opinion from some expert about what you should be doing, it's saying, hey, there is no expert on what you should be doing other than you in relationship to the entire world. So why not listen a little bit more deeply? And if nothing's coming to you, then be patient. You know, take some time, listen a little bit more deeply, let things unfold. And then if the enormity of what you're facing is, as we've been talking about today, then the house really is on fire. So we are being called to act and not just sit around for 20 years perseverating on like, what is my true calling? But just take the first step, whatever it is, even if it's a mistake. The mistake will, you know, tell you, show you very rapidly where you're off and where you need to go. So I think that that's really the path of learning, growing, healing, and transformation, all wrapped up in paying attention to this moment as if it really mattered and as, your, and as if your life really, really depended on it. And, and it does. All of Amishi's research is showing that it does. And all of art is showing that, like, okay, you see this painting or you hear this piece of music, but if you don't let it enter, then you've missed that moment. It may never come around again. So let's be open to experience moment by moment by moment. That is mindfulness. And especially if you're also open to your own body, then it's embodied mindfulness, so that it's not separate, but it's part of, and right down to your breath, right down to every step you take and every beat of your heart.
I think we might have time for two more questions. I'm going to direct this one to Barbara. This one's from Dan. And I think it's kind of an interesting question to direct towards you, since you have an instrument that's 300 years old that you have a relationship with. And his question is that there are powerful financial interests that design current products that keep us focused to the detriment of our overall awareness. Is there any suggestions or ideas that can be done at a societal level to combat this?
Well, that's a very powerful question. And I think that the forces that are out there that are trying to direct our attention for various reasons, whether it's profit or a particular political message, that's very, very difficult to overcome. And I think that, as both Amishi and John have talked about, trying to really establish your own sense of center and of the brain's ability to be a truth regulator, it's a very difficult process. And it's something that getting in touch with your own center and establishing some kind of a regular practice that does quiet your mind from all of the extraneous noise that's going on is probably the best prescription that we can think of. And I also wanted to remark upon what both Amishi and John have talked about with, you know, the science and the scientific research. And just as with Amishi's experience in India, you know, my husband is a neuroscientist who studies the effects of meditation on the brain, but that's not why I come to meditation. That's not why I find it valuable. And that's, nor is that why he came to meditation. I think just the experience of sitting quietly and allowing yourself to accept wherever your mind goes and then just gently bring it back and be aware of your breath and maintain a quiet, calm focus, that can have very far-reaching effects in your own way of being and your own interaction with other people and your own access to your innate compassion. And that can then manifest itself in the world in myriad ways.
Thank you. Thank you, Barbara. I think we have time for one more question. This is for this is from Sonam. And I'll direct this to Amishi. As a student, I'm distracted by social media and my phone as a form of digital dementia. It's really eating out my valuable time, but at the same time, I couldn't leave it Do you have suggestions for what my condition is?
I love that. Digital dementia. I think I suffer from that as well. I think you know what your condition is. I don't think I have to prescribe anything in terms of characterizing it. And I think you're really capturing the challenge of this. We cannot break up with our phones. We cannot decide to just turn off the computer and never touch it again. It's almost like food, right? We need it. It's like air. We need it. We need it to do our basic functions in this modern and complex world. And it goes back to the point I raised kind of at the top of our time together, which is the answer is not to go to war against digital distraction. Is not to sort of lay down the law of like, I'm going to do this or that. Though, you know, I think there are some successful strategies you might consider implementing, like turning off your notifications if you actually aren't expecting something urgent, for example. But I think that, you know, there are some things we can do to kind of manage and not further disable ourselves. Because as I mentioned, attention is a limited capacity system. And what I mean by that is that we spend it out. There's a certain available to us, and the more we engage and utilize it, the less and less we have available to us. And one of the things that is the most costly for our attention is multitasking. And the reason is there is no such thing as multitasking. It's actually task switching, which means that we're engaging our full focus into something, and then we're having to disengage it, move it to another thing, engage it again. And that lag time is not just time lost, it is energy. Cognitive energy lost. So the more you can limit putting yourself in a situation where you're forced to multitask, the better, because you're conserving your own cognitive resources. But the bigger problem and the bigger challenge, or the bigger, I wouldn't say challenge or problem, let's say opportunity, is this. Don't go to battle in a direct way. Let's try to have a different way of interacting with our digital landscape right now, which is something we can practice daily. And that has to do with becoming, and I love the phrase, and I actually wanted to say it again, befriending our attention. If just like a good friend or somebody you really care about, you keep tabs on them. Where is this person? Are they okay? Where are they putting their life energy, right? We kind of monitor the things that are deeply of care and concern to us. Let's do that for our own attention. And if we can have that kind of moment-to-moment monitoring, we can catch ourselves, we can protect ourselves in ways that will really be beneficial to our day-to-day functioning. In some ways, it's the repair function for what you call digital dementia. It's gonna be the thing that's gonna make you feel more and more capable, because you're conserving the energy for yourself and for what you decide is where you wanna put your mind.
And if I could jump in just for a second on that, because Amishi is, a world expert on working memory and how it degrades under stress, that this is really a place where your intention can make a huge degree of difference. When you notice a thought in the mind that says, I've got to check my device, I've got to check my email, you can actually cultivate mindfulness around that impulse to constantly check. And what the reason for that is that you might be missing something, or you can, you know, a moment might go by where you don't know what's happening. And in this way, you can actually bring your full bore analog intelligence to your relationship with the digital world in ways that will enhance the working memory that holds in mind moment by moment awareness itself. And the importance of being embodied in wakefulness and kindness towards oneself. So that's akin to playing your own instrument, so to speak. And I just wanted to loop that in, because your research, Amishi, has shown so much how stress will degrade working memory. And there's all sorts of new ways in which working memory is being highlighted as absolutely critical to living in this domain of what's called holistic implicate knowing. And that's exactly what you need to remember to be mindful in this moment.
Thank you. Oh, just that last question alone was a great takeaway for me. And it leads me to ask this final question that we always ask at the end of every Inspiring Minds episode. And that is, what is one action step or insight that each of you feel that you want to take away from this time today, together, this time with each other? You know, what's something that you're reflecting upon as you leave this conversation today? And maybe just a minute or two each. Let's start with you, Barbara, if that's okay.
Yes, it was wonderful to hear Amishi and John speak to these issues and things that we all struggle with. How do we monitor our attention? How do we befriend our attention? How do we use it in the best way for ourselves and for doing good in the world? And I'm going to keep that phrase, befriend my attention, because rather than feel like we're pushing away thoughts or trying to change where our mind is going or critiquing ourselves and saying, why can't I stay focused on this? As I say to my cello students, you should be critical of the sound, not the self. So if we can befriend our attention and just gently, kindly bring it back when it wanders away, then that's something that that I will take with me, that wonderful phrase.
Thank you. John, would you like to share? And also our audience, please feel free to drop your takeaways in the chat with each other.
Well, I just feel extremely privileged to be here with the three of you having this conversation. It's an ongoing and open conversation. And I hope that all of us who have been here together, whatever time zone you're in, we'll continue the conversation inwardly through our own multiple ways of being and outwardly in our relationships with each other, and also how we act in the face of really challenging circumstances. Because very often, mindfulness doesn't immunize you to the impulse to protect yourself when you feel too uncomfortable. I've noticed that millions of times in myself. And so it's not a question of presenting some kind of ideal face where you've got everything under control, but actually a realization that, or an awareness that you don't have anything under control and you're just going with the flow, but keeping in mind what's most important, and then bringing that into the body in ways that Barbara was suggesting, by bringing back your attention right into your own belly, right into your own heart, right into your own feet, and not losing touch with the air and with the earth.
Mishi, closing reflections.
Really, this is inspired by Barbara and the beautiful, beautiful music that launched our time together today. I thought it was just exactly what my aching heart needed in some ways, and it energized me so profoundly. So I guess my takeaway is, you know, so much of our conversation today, so much of my life, I'm sure most others in this kind of collective conversation, is around the task at hand, the demand at hand, solving the big problems, you know, get it done, get the work done, constrain, control. And that is, of course, our modern lives. But I wanted to just remind myself and share with you all that it's not just about the concentrative, directed, willful expending of our energy. That part of what we need to do, we absolutely need to do, not a nice to have, a must have, is loosen the reins and allow the mind to go wherever it will. And that is just as important as tightening the reins to control it. And I think what Barbara provided at the top of our time together was a reminder that art, music are such wonderful teachers to be able to do that, so that we can just let go for a little bit, and we all need to let go for a little bit.
Thank you. Thank you, all three of you, once more. I want to close and maybe loosen the reins a little bit and let go and close this session with a few reflections and closing thoughts. Our attention, our primary basis for our understanding and our interconnectedness with humanity and the natural world, these are the things we talked about in today's episode. In its vulnerable state, it's under an onslaught, constantly being seduced by digital information. We're captivated, we're enstrained in autopilot mode, and we aren't aware that these external phenomena doesn't have our best interest at heart. So for all of you, let's start being aware of our unawareness. Let's pay attention to our attention. Let's ask where our mind goes. Mindfulness is a love affair within that what is deep and best in us as human beings, and it allows us to take care of ourselves and take care of the world. So let's befriend our attention, as John said, embrace our analog selves, ground ourselves, and move forward in this ever-changing world. I want to thank each of you in our community for trusting me to hold space and for you as the community and the speakers over this course of season one, Inspiring Minds. It's really been an honor getting to dive deeper as a practitioner with these topics that sometimes can make us uncomfortable, but are necessary to turn and face and engage in. I'm gonna be returning for season two in August. And some of the issues that I'll be addressing include addiction and recovery, intergenerational trauma, and healing our human earth connection even further. Thank you so much, all of you here today, for joining us. Gratitude, deep gratitude for our Mind and Life team that works behind the scenes. And please continue to stay connected to Mind and Life as we move forward in these challenging times. I'm going to close by bringing John in to lead us in a guided meditation, and then Barbara will offer a closing musical offering. Thank you.
Well, thank you one and all. And let's take the last few moments together and establish ourselves, no matter what time zone you happen to be in, maybe the middle of the night or early morning, in a posture that embodies wakefulness and dignity and a deep appreciation of your own aliveness in this moment. There's nothing, especially in the time of COVID, that attacks the respiratory system. There's nothing like the breath to remind us and rebody us, but especially to remind us that we're alive in this moment. So let's actually open to that life in us in this moment and drop in on ourselves. And feel the breath moving in and out of the body. Which is tantamount to saying, pay attention to it. And in the attending, invite yourself to ride on the waves of the breath sensations in the body. And then rest in the awareness itself, moment by moment by moment, as we rest here, falling awake. And so again, since that word seemed to land in a good way, befriending stillness. That's certainly an antidote to digital distraction. Befriending silence, a silence that's synonymous with stillness and has no issue with sound. Without silence, there would be no music. So learning how to fully inhabit the space, the boundless space of your own awareness, right in this moment, and resting here, taking up residency as your default mode, so to speak, in wakefulness, in presence, in awareness, in attending. Rilke famously said in one of his poems, "I am the rest between two notes, which are somehow always in discord because death's note wants to climb over, but in the dark interval, reconciled, they stay here trembling," that is, the notes stay here trembling, and the song goes on. Beautiful. So dropping into silence. And simply giving yourself over to being the knowing that you're attending, your awareness already is.
Thank you for your kind attention.